I'm sitting here with David Karsbøl, who's chief economist of Saxo Bank. David, we've had a mixed bunch of indicators this week, with something for people who are positive, something for people who are negative. Has it had any impact on your outlook?
I think our outlook is pretty much stable after this week's data. Perhaps a little notch upwards after the some of the data. We saw the ISM figures, the ISM manufacturing and non-manufacturing were both below the 50 mark, which is demarking the line between contraction and expansion. So both the manufacturing and the services sector in the US are still in contraction or recessionary mode. And the non-manufacturing ISM was actually surprising a little to the downside. We saw the ADP employment change was better than expected. We were quite surprised about that, because if you look at the initial and continuing jobless claims that are released on a weekly basis, they are suggesting that the we're still losing jobs on a massive rate every week. And that is, it's of course, the ADP employment change was still indicating a massive job loss, but not as horrible as the one suggested by the jobless claims. So it'll be very interesting today to see the non-farm payrolls, and the market is expecting minus 325,000. Some of the big dealers in the market are saying that it'll be even better, perhaps minus 275,000. But if we should stick to the continuing claims, both the continuing and initial jobless claims, they are suggesting that we should see a number to the tune of minus 450,000. So, and at the same time, the July is where we are seeing this one of the adjustments in the so-called birth-death model.
Okay, and that's birth-death of companies rather than employees.
Yes, yeah. Exactly. And so that's where they're doing some adjustments. And so this month's figure, this day's figure, will be quite important in that respect. Also, if we look at the chain store sales, they're down 5%, so that's still not too impressive. What we're seeing in this trend is that even the low-cost retailers are getting hit. So Walmart and Costco are feeling the heat now, as well as the high-end that had been hit previously in this crisis. Mm-hmm. So I think that's a bit of a concern. Now.
You've also have some concerns about the banks still, about banks being that have been taken over, about their financial standing.
Yes, that's true. I mean, we have been quite skeptical with regards to the accounting standards, how trustworthy they are, especially after this so-called Rule 157 in the FASB was relaxed at the mid of March this year. Where previously bank companies had been forced to mark their assets to market in a very stringent way, they have now this rule has been relaxed in a way that basically makes it less transparent what they actually have on their books. But what we can see now is that the banks that are being taken over by the FDIC have roughly a cost-to-assets ratio, I mean the cost of closing these companies, or the cost to the taxpayers of closing them, are roughly 30% of their assets that they are claiming to have. And in a world of leverage, I mean in the bank world, where most banks are operating with a leverage of 10 to 1, or perhaps in reality 15 to 1 or 20 to 1 to their equity, that, of course, is disastrous and suggesting that a lot of banks out there are still insolvent, and not only insolvent, they are massively insolvent, but really they are zombie banks. And what we're seeing in the figures is that the trend is actually worsening. So the cost to asset ratio is on the increase. And also, especially, of course, after the FSB 157 rule was relaxed at the mid of March.
Okay, so that's going to hold up a recovery as well?
It will be detrimental to the outlook for lending. Of course, it will not continue or they will be tightening or continuing with tight lending standards as long as they are on the brink of insolvency. And that's what the figures are suggesting right now.
Mm-hmm. Now, we had US quarter two GDP figures out last week, and you've got some interesting comments on the way the figures are put together as well.
Well, I mean, it's the figure was slightly surprising to the upside on the aggregate, because the market was expecting minus 1.5%. It came out at 1% real growth, or sorry, minus 1% real growth annualized in the second quarter. But if you subtract the government contributions, I mean the defense spending, the non-defense spending, the state and local spending, the private part of the GDP was actually out at minus 3%. So one of the analysts here in the bank suggested that it should be the government domestic product, because that's really government spending was saving the overall GDP figure from the second quarter. And I think this is not really a positive, because you would really this really boils down to whether the government will be able to continue borrowing money, issuing bonds in the bonds market, and continuing this, because that is the bonds that are issued go directly into spending, and the spending is calculated directly as part of GDP. So of course they can keep up GDP figures as long as they can continue borrowing. But we suggest that it'll be at a higher cost if they're continuing like this and issuing as much treasuries as they have been doing in the past couple of weeks and months.
Okay, so we're not out of the woods yet.
We are definitely not out of the woods yet, and we are quite worried that this trend will continue, and that everybody will look for the GDP to be held up by the government spending. And well, in long term, the government spending is less productive than the private spending, private uses of capital, and that's why the government is really forcing or pulling forward the demand. So if they're spending the money, you know, you will have to pay higher taxes in the future, and that's what's called the Ricardian equivalence, that the consumers can they know that they'll bear the or they'll have to pay the bill in the future, and therefore they are scaling back on their consumption.
Okay, David, thanks a lot for that.